land, because the disciples of Christ understood this truth is more than just about reading the scriptures. This truth is about action. This truth is about doing. And this is what the disciples showed us. Your job, brothers, black man, Latin man, is to look out after your brothers and sisters that have need. If they have need, you as a leader is to fulfill the need. If they have no food, what is reading a scripture to them going to do? If they have no clothes to wear, what is reading a scripture going to do for them? Nothing. Let's get that in James now. James told you about you faith-only brothers.
What the other read in Acts was there was a system in place. Okay, people are going to come to us after we've read them the scriptures. Let's put something in place so when they come to us, we can help them.
This truth is about building the nation of Israel. They're going to come in sick. They're going to come in naked. They're going to come in hungry. It's not just read a verse. That's a part of it. I'm not knocking. That's the main thing. But behind that, we have to do those things necessary for them to survive.
Shalom, Israel. This is Officer Josiah. I'm here with Captain Malachi, Captain of 500, leader of the Captains and Officers of Israel United in Christ. Captain, this is the first question I'm going to ask. How did you come into the truth? Second part of the question is, what led you to this congregation?
Well, my story is a little different from I guess from everybody else. I did 5 years in federal prison. So I come from the street. Well, I don't really come from the street, but I grew up in the street. And by me growing up in the street, I end up serving 5 years in federal prison. And after I do my time, I decided to move. I actually come from Connecticut, but I decided to move to New York. Some of you know my little brother, Labaka, Deacon Labaka. And one day, I was in my room, and I give him a call because he still live in Connecticut and I'm in New York. And I give him a call, I say, because me and him always, even when I was locked up, he always sent me scriptures about the truth, because I was deep into Christianity, foolishness. And we was talking, but I didn't have a fully understanding of the truth. And after I come out of the blue, one day I give him a call. I said, hey, brother, don't you say that there is some brothers in New York that you congregate with sometimes? And he said, yeah. And I said, give me the phone number. He said, no. Go online first. He gave me the website. That night, I didn't go to sleep until 3, 4 o'clock in the morning because I was reading. And everything I was reading made perfect sense. And I was reading, look at the Bible, look at the scriptures, and it makes sense. And then I said, why don't you give me the phone number and the address? He said, no, I'll give you. I said, give me the address. I want to go over there. At that time, and then the time you left, he was living in Brooklyn. He said, no, brother, you cannot just show up at brother's house. The brother don't know you like that. He said, we have Wednesday class. Let me talk to the brother first. But I think that when he come to Wednesday class, he forget to talk to Netanyahu, so I can't show up on Saturday. But after I keep bugging him, he said, okay, here's the address. He give me the address. I jump in the train. When I get there, I was the first one there, all scared. I knock at the door. And then I was like, who's this? And I said, it's Malachi. I said, it's Malachi because I picked up my name. You know, I picked up my name before I come with the truth. So I said, it's Malachi. He said, do I know you? I said, oh, I'm Labakai, brother. Oh, he said, oh, come in, brother, come in. Since then, I never leave. And it was a life changing for me, I can tell you that. Mosai gave me a second chance. And I used that second chance to better my life. Because remember, I ended up in jail, but some brothers end up dying. Some brothers, I could have get shot, I could have been dead, but I look at it as a second chance. So I used that as a second chance. And also, been a while, brothers like Elder Netanyahu, Elder Kanai. At that time, as some of you know, there was another elder. I learned a lot from these brothers. I learned a lot. These brothers always been a father figure to me. I always look up to them. And then you got the deacons. I learned a lot from these brothers. And to tell the truth, I'm still learning. That's how I come in this shoot, and that's how I end up with Israel tonight.
All right. Enlighten our viewers on your first camp experience, whether it be reading, whether it be teaching, handing out flyers, holding posts, etc.
My first camp experience is a funny one. When I first go to camp with Elder Netanyahu, and at that time, like I said, we had another elder with us. It was me, Deacon Malakaya, there was another brother, Paul, who was with us. I think Officer Young come later on, if I'm not mistaken. He come later on, but it was only like 10, 3 or 4 of us. The first time I go to camp with the elders, the elder said, because remember, we used to use a microphone. The elder said, "Hey, Malakai, come with." The first time I start reading, I just opened my mouth. He's like, no, get out of here. You gotta read loud, brother. In my mind, I'm thinking I'm reading loud, but it wasn't loud enough. He said, no, give me another read. After that, from that day on, people, brothers have to tell me I'm too loud. Because that's how much I change. So my first conference was a good one, man. I don't know how to describe it, bro. It was because I always have that fear, even in the world, I have that fear that I'm nervous when I'm speaking in front of people. But coming in the truth, when you're teaching the word, which is a spiritual thing, it's a whole different ballgame. Because it's not your word you're speaking. You're speaking the word of Most High God. Even sometimes I'm looking at some of those videos on YouTube that of myself, I can't believe that's me. Some of the things I'm saying, I can't believe I'm saying that. That's how you know this is a spiritual thing. It's a really good experience. I have a really good experience. And like I said, since then I never miss a day of camp. I always at camp. It was a good experience. Upwards to Most High.
Where was the campsite?
The campsite was at Utica and Nostrand. We was there for a long time too, actually. Until we moved to the Bronx and Queens, but that was the first camp I went to was Utica and Nostrand. That was the first camp I went to.
Eastern Parkway.
Yes. Utica and Eastern Parkway. That was the first camp I went to.
Alright. Your first time was reading?
My first time was reading.
Alright. Talk about your first teaching experience.
My first teaching experience, man, was... Well, let me tell you. My problem is, even when I was in the world, is keeping things in my head. I'm one of these brothers. I know some brothers got photographic memory. I don't have that. I never blessed with that. Some brothers must have blessed them with photographic memory. Me, I have to keep reading, studying over again for me to get it, for me to keep it in my head.
Same here, bro.
My first experience at camp, I remember I come with a little piece of paper. Some brothers still doing it today. And one day, Elder Netanyahu make a comment. He said, listen, what if somebody come in and snatch that little piece of paper? What you gonna do then? Then you just gonna be like, oh, brothers, put another brother? Since he said that, I never bring another piece of paper again. Because that was something for me to think about. And I'm like, he said, you know, if somebody snatch that piece of paper, you go blind. I mean, that's what you write. Because in my mind, I'm thinking, you know how you go home, you prepare something, you say, oh, I'm going to go over this at camp, I'm going over that at camp. And when I first come in, I thought that's what this is about. But that's not what it's about. The truth is not about that. It's about you going there, whatever you learn, teach it. If you only know Deuteronomy 28, teach Deuteronomy 28. Because at that time, that's what Moses revealed to you. If Moses only revealed you Deuteronomy 28, teach Deuteronomy 28. There's nothing wrong with a brother just go to camp, just teach Deuteronomy 28. If that's all you know. It's not about how many scriptures you know. It's about waking up the people. The goal is to waken up your people. It's not about you. It's about the work. So that was my first experience of teaching. In my mind, I'm thinking it's about writing the little piece of note. But at the time, you say, no. Whatever you know, brother, that's what you got to teach. Don't try to teach something that you don't know. Don't worry about brothers who know scripture after scripture. Don't worry about that. That's not what this is about. It's about pushing this truth, wake up your people, so we can get out of here. That's what this is about.
Well said, brother. Well said. All right. Third question. It's a two-part question. What are you doing in this truth now? I want you to talk about your tasks, your duties, the things that you are involved with that come with your position. And where do you see yourself, and what do you see yourself doing in this truth in about 10 years?
Well, in this truth, brother, I tell you this, the more higher you get, the more responsibility. In other words, what I'm saying is, the more leadership role they give you, the more responsibilities you have. My responsibility for me is, as some of you know, I'm no longer living in New York. I moved to Atlanta, Georgia. Right now in Atlanta, Georgia, we have about nine brothers. And when I went to Atlanta, I wasn't planning to be the leader in Atlanta. That wasn't my plan. My plan was, I was going through some hard time in New York. I decided to leave New York. I cannot take New York no more. But when I get to Atlanta, there was other brothers already there, but the brothers wasn't going to camp. And as I'm starting talking, talk to the brothers, and I'm telling the brothers, listen, we got to go to camp. We got to do this, we got to do that. You got brothers who was in the truth for a couple of years. They was only passing flights. They wasn't going to camp. And I'm telling the brothers, listen, you got to watch the videos. The way you build yourself up is watching, make sure you're on class on Wednesday, class camp 101, watching the videos so you can teach. When I went over there, I think it's about 2 weeks after I get there, I took the brothers to camp. Some brothers was nervous, but I said, listen, this is what it's about. It's about learning. I said, listen, you cannot be worse than what you are. When you first come in, of course it's gonna be a slow process, but eventually you're gonna get better. I tried to build brother confidence up. Opposite to my side, guess what? Now brothers is teaching. Now the school is going in Atlanta. My goal in 10 years, upwards to Mosiah, my goal is to see Israel unite, become bigger in Atlanta than in New York. That's my goal. I know it's a big goal. That's my goal. The school, we have the headquarters in New York. And I don't want no brothers to make no mistake about it. There is no such a thing as Atlanta camp. Atlanta is a Israel unite Atlanta camp. That's what it is. Israel unite Atlanta. That's what it is. The goal is, whatever we do here in New York, that's what Atlanta gotta do. That's the goal. Because we are Israel unite. We just happen to be in Atlanta, that's all. But we are Israel unite. So that's my goal. In 10 years from now, my goal is to, for Mosiah, to bless us in Atlanta for our camp to be bigger than New York. I know it's something, I know your brother nothing is impossible, but nothing is impossible with Mosiah. That's the goal. Because as you can see right now, we're growing fast. We actually looking for a place. So we're growing fast. So, upwards to Mosiah, that's my prayer, that's my goal. But at the same time too though, I don't want a bunch of wicked men around me either. You remember what the scripture said? I want to be with 5-6 brothers, you know, that's keeping the laws, instead of with a bunch of 40-50 Negroes who's not keeping the laws. That's the goal, to be up there to spread this truth in Atlanta, because you know there's that homosexuality over there is running rapid. It's crazy over there. The goal is to go out there, teach the word, and you know, hopefully brothers and sisters repent in the spirit of Christ and keep the laws. That's my goal.
Alright, bro. Well said. Now this is the portion of the interview where you can turn to the camera, give our brothers an inspirational message, and you say a piece there.
Well, my message is to your brothers is that in this truth, never think about yourself. One thing I always tell brothers in Atlanta is that you have the power in your tongue to destroy a brother. You have the power in your tongue to build a brother up. It's up to you which one you want to choose. Our job in this truth is to build each other up. Any brother will tell you different, that's from the devil. Another thing that I push a lot is you cannot be a leader if you don't want to be an example. They go hand in hand. It makes no sense. You say, I'm a leader. You want to give order, but you don't want to be an example. And Nathaniel once tell me, he said, a great leader have to be ready to not only give order, but also learn how to take order. A lot of brothers know how to give order, but they don't like how to take order. To be a great leader, you have to learn how to take order too, bro. It's not about giving order. In this truth, we have to learn how to push each other, support each other. When one hurt, we all hurt. Whatever one brother is going through, we all going through it. That's my advice to your brothers. All right, with that, I say shalom.
Shalom, Israel. This is Officer Josiah. I'm here with Captain Shem. And in this portion of the video, we're going to explore the officers in the leadership structure of Israel United in Christ. We're going to explore what they're doing to be on the forefront of spreading the Most High's truth and getting the laws out to the people. All right, the first question I'm going to ask Officer Shem. Brother, how did you come into the truth and what led you to this congregation?
Well, going back to the year 98, Deacon Shockey, who is actually my wife's brother, began to talk to me about the truth. And I think I was at the time 19 or 20. And I remember him coming at me like hard and like just being like intimidated. Like, damn, why? I don't even really know him that well. He on me, like, finding all these things wrong with me and saying this and that. And from that point forward, you know, I married Michelle, who was Shockey's sister in the year 2000. So the whole time I had interactions with Deacon Shockey, who's now Deacon Shockey. And what we did end up doing is he kept planting the seed and watering the seed. And how I came fully into the truth, it was the year 2007. What happened, let me just give a little background about myself. I spent a little bit of time in the Marines, and I went to multiple colleges, and I went and I got a bachelor's degree and a master's degree, and I had very good grades, and I thought that I was making something of myself in this white man's world. But then when the Most High, what he did to me is, the same year that I was woken up, I lost my job, my house, I lost in foreclosure. I had to move out of my house in the winter of 2008 in the snow, no power, no nothing. And I remember at that point, it was the lowest point in my life. And the Most High brought me low, real low. And that's when I realized that this is the truth. And I remember I was sitting around, I'm trying to keep it concise, I was sitting around, a brother named Hashia, speaking of Shakin, Hashia, Labakar, who was in Connecticut. And I didn't wake up from the curses. I woke up from Exodus, I think it was Exodus 31. I forget what scripture, it might have been Exodus 15 when they went up to the mountain, and it was in the bottom of the mountain. Moses said, don't let them go up to the mountain, because if they come to the base, they should be destroyed. Something along the lines of that, I'm paraphrasing. And I said, sound like my people. So they, like, and then they said they didn't want to be destroyed. Like they was pushing the edge of everything. It sounded and just reminded me of my people. And from that point forward, I was sitting around the round table, and I remember it was like a light went off. And I said in front of the brothers, I said, yo, that's my people. I was talking about my people. From that point forward, man, I fellowship with Hashia, Labakar, and the brother Shakia in Connecticut for several months. And I remember the second part of the question I think you asked, how did I come to this congregation? The way I came from this, I'll never forget. I remember that my brother Shaki was like, listen, you need to take a look at this book. And so the name of the book was called Understandings Without Readers. So I started to read the book, and long story short, I said, I don't know who this brother is, man. This right here, what he's saying makes sense. So then I began to start to look at YouTube, and I remember seeing a video of Elder Nathaniel teaching. I didn't know too much about him, but I remember that day, the brother had like a gold shirt on. It wasn't even a garment. And I said, I don't know what that. I said, that's from God back then. I said, I need to get around that brother. And Deacon Labakar, who was at the time, was an old deacon at the time, he started to make the trip all the way to, at the time it was Sister Ezra's house. We used to go over there on Long Island. I started to roll with him up here, make the sacrifice to roll up. And ever since then, you know, I look at all these brothers, Elder Nathaniel, Elder Kanan, Deacon Yawsa, okay, Deacon Asap, Deacon Shakir. I look at all these brothers like they're my father figures. and I reverence and I cherish, I use that word cherish, the relationship that I have with those men. It taught me structure and order. And so without getting too much further, that's how I came to Israel United Christ. And Lord will, I'm going to be here for another 55, 60 years, but most I will until Christ comes back.
Damn, well, praise, bro. Praises. All right, let's go into our second question. When you start being a student, there's something that's expected of you. When the time comes, when you're a seasoned man, when you understand the curses, you understand your history, you understand your laws, you understand what's expected of being an Israelite, the time comes to go and teach your people. At first you might read, at first you might hold posts, but it's all the same. Get off the book, sit up, stand up, get out the door and start to teach your people. Captain Shen, tell us about your first camp experience.
I want to touch first on my first Connecticut experience. It's myself, Lava Deacon Lava, then Lava Carr, and Deacon Shockey at the time. We went started to teach by ourselves, us three in Connecticut by ourselves. And the difference between Connecticut and out here is that in New York, there's a lot of people. But out there, it's a different environment. And I had to get used to that. So teaching in Connecticut was not as busy. However, Deacon Shockey, the brother is, the Most High used that brother to mold me into a leader because he was so hard on me. I mean, austere with me. And at the time, I'm like, damn, why is he so damn hard with me? And then as I started to grow in the truth, I realized, because if I can learn to be disciplined under this man, when I become a leader, I'll know how to stand on my own. And I learned that from that brother. I learned how to be austere from that brother. But jumping forward to New York, I'll never forget when we started to first come up into New York's camp. And I remember saying, damn, all these people. Damn, what am I going to do? What am I going to do if I don't know what to say? What am I going to say? And I just remember facing the fear. The first times I'll never forget, we was in Queens. It was a hot block, very hot, meaning very many, a lot of people around. And Shaka said, at the time, my name was Kyle. He said, Kyle, he said, get up there and teach. And I'm like, oh, shoot. And I said, damn, I'm trying to think what scriptures I knew. I had to say, you know what? I had to make the decision right then and there. I can either keep being scared my whole life, afraid of what, I wasn't scared of getting beat down. I was scared of not knowing what to say. That was my fear. But I said, you know what? I said, we got this knowledge, and I'm going to sit there and be selfish because I'm afraid of what people might think of me, man. So I went up there and I taught the curses, and I taught hard as I put everything I could into it. And from that day, I never turned back. I always bring 100% every time I hit the block, whether it's holding posts, whether it's reading. And you brothers out there, when you hit the street, man, holding posts and reading is an honor, okay? Teaching this should be the last phase. You should know how to hold posts, militancy. When you read with everything you've got, man. Everything you got, you bring every ounce of power you have and back up the Most High word. That's what our mission is at camp, man. We warriors. We got to act like that. So that was my first time at camp. Just got up there and taught Deuteronomy 28. And that was basically it.
Now we're going to explore your role inside Israel United in Christ. Tell our viewers what your position, what you've been doing in this truth now, and where do you see yourself in this truth laboring in 10 years?
Well, now what I do is United in Christ. Currently, was promoted to captain of 500. I was formerly also 50. And what I'm doing right now in the New York branch, what I do is I conduct offices, bi-monthly meetings will be setting military structure and what's the word I'm looking for? Logistical unveiling of action plans. Instead of just brothers have good ideas, we're gonna take those good ideas, we're gonna form a system and a chain of command set up, and we passing the orders down. And that's myself over the officers. Secondly, also I also help out setting up military. We have a military drill that we do where brothers get together in formation and they learn to move, sing, step and stay coordinated as one body, one machine, one unit.
That's the Camp 101 on Wednesdays.
Yes, Camp 101 on Wednesdays, which initially was given the exhortation to Deacon Shockey, because that was his initial thing. And I basically changed the guard of the government of Texas to now from the NAPA.
All right, bro, you're doing a bang-up job. I'll say that straight. All right, now, where do you see your role in this truth in 10 years?
You know, I was looking at that question. Officer Josiah, I was trying to come up with a really dazzling answer. And I started thinking, yeah, you know, I want to have my own congregation, some state, you know. But what I can say is that I want to, Lord's will still be in this truth. Still teaching. Hopefully we have multiple congregations throughout the tri-state area. And if the Most High have it that way, I could be one of the leaders of those congregations, such as what Officer Captain Malachi is doing right now in Atlanta. The Spirit, the Most High Spirit moved me to be a leader and example for brothers in a place where truth needs to be established. So I hope to be a builder, trying to push this truth, to be the Lord will.
All right. Lastly, Shem, is there any message you got for the viewers out there watching this?
Yeah, I'm gonna say this. All you brothers in the other states, okay? It doesn't matter where you're from, where you live at, okay? You cannot be selfish. You know, you got all our people out there, they need the truth. And we are very few brothers that know the truth. Like the scriptures say, the truth shall make you free. So it's time, man, to stop being selfish, man. Learn these scriptures, man. And Elder Nathaniel's got all type of tapes set up for you. If you need to understand it, then watch the tape again, okay? Keeping the commandments, meditating on the law, okay? Applying your mind towards prophecy. So when you get out there, no fear, and teach your people the truth. We got to wake our people up, man. I don't care if there's only two of you, man. You got to use Officer Miami in Chicago. Brother was by himself for a while. Mosai sent a labor to that brother. Now he's got two laborers. So now it's time that we wake our people up, man. You brothers start to stand up, man. Prophecy's being fulfilled as we speak, Ezekiel 37. We are rising up. The spirit of life is coming into us, man. That army is being assembled as we speak. And if you believe in that, man, you're going to go teach your people. And you know, guess what? You're going to be faced with fear, man. Some brothers are scared of heights. They got to get over that fear. They got to face their fear. Some of you brothers might be scared. I don't know what to say. Damn, I might not be as good a teacher as Deacon Yawas. Who cares, man? You represent what you can do for the Most High. Study to show that self-approved. Hit the street. Okay? We are the doggone, the beacons of light for our people. And it's like you're going to take, like Christ said, you're going to take your lamp and you're going to, your candle, you're going to put it under a dim and hide it. Now you gotta let it shine. So we're gonna let our light shine before men, all our people. That's the message I have for you, brothers, man. Be strong, man. Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might.
Shalom, Israel. I'm here with Captain Yahshua of Israelite in Christ. I'm gonna ask him a few questions. Captain Yahshua, I explained to the viewers how you came into the truth and what led you to this congregation, as opposed to all the others out there.
Well, I had been in a time in my life where I had like a lot of disruption going on, and it was a lot of instability. It was weird because I felt like something was missing. I couldn't put my finger on it. I thought it was something maybe to do with my relationship at the time. Maybe it was the job. I was seeking like some sort of fulfillment. Like I would battle with bouts of like depression. Like I wasn't sure what was going on. I remember distinctly, I had called my cousin, happens to be Officer Bezalel with Israel United in Christ, to invite him to, I think it was a Memorial Day barbecue. Pretty sure it was Memorial Day. And, you know, I didn't know that I knew he was going through some stuff, that he was learning some things. He had come and had shown me some stuff about Christmas one time. But I had called him the conspiracy theorist thing. Me and Officer Aviel had a thing where we call him the conspiracy theorist dude because, you know, he had it all mixed up with stuff, but it was interesting. Anyway, I called him to invite him to the barbecue, and on that phone conversation, he was explaining to me how he couldn't come, and, you know, he had quoted some scriptures, and I was kind of like, all right, whatever. And then, you know, I was ready to get off the phone. He was like, hey, man, you know, you got a second? And I was like, yeah. And he basically starts going into how Puerto Ricans are in the Bible. And, you know, it piqued my interest. So he started breaking down Deuteronomy 28. I was one of those so-called Latinos that understood the history of our people, going back to what the island was called, to, you know, the Arawak Indians and all that, you know. So I wasn't real ignorant of that. I knew we were in captivity. I knew the type of things. I knew Columbus wasn't a good man. So it kept me intrigued as he's going through it. And then what really kind of put the nail in the coffin, you know, so to speak, was when he started going over Second Esdras with me, and he's talking about the migration here. And from that point on, man, I was like hooked. I remember the next day I called up Officer Abiel, and I started talking to him about it. And just by default, that's why I came to this congregation. This was the only congregation I ever knew. I had seen other Israelites, 42nd Street, Fordham, things like that, you know, when I was younger. Always thinking, like, you know, man, these guys are angry. What the heck are they talking about? I never really would stop and listen or anything like that. So my first real true exposure to this truth was through Israel United in Christ. And that's how I became part of the body.
All right. Okay, so you're attending the Sabbath service. You're repenting. You're getting to know brothers. And I remember at the time you came in, the camp wasn't developed. The camp experience, like as we know today, was non-existent.
No, it's totally different.
Explain to everybody how your first camp experience was. Either it be speaking, reading, teaching, or holding posts or giving out flyers, whatever you were doing.
I guess if I can, I want to briefly explain kind of the first experience reading, and then just the first experience period, because the first experience was kind of funny. There was really no structure to anything, like, you know, like you kind of alluded to. It's very different. The manifestation we have now at camp was not what it was then. No uniforms. Everybody kind of went however they were dressed. You know, you had to have your fringes and whatnot, but there wasn't even any type of color coordination. I think me and my brother had went, like, in shorts and sneakers.
Who was your brother?
Apario.
Officer Apario.
Yeah, so... And we had went like in shorts and sneakers, and it was in Brooklyn and
Eastern Parkway. Right?
Yeah, it was Eastern Parkway, and it was like one part in awe of being around the teachers that we had seen on videos and had, you know, heard on audios, and, you know, not being in the classroom but now seeing them on the street, like seeing them in the battleground, you know. So it was kind of like a little bit in awe, like, you know, I guess almost a little starstruck, like, oh, you know, these are the people that, you know, I've been speaking to my spirit with these scriptures. And then the other part was just not really knowing what to do. Like, you know, like, okay, here, give out flyers. You know, who do we give them out to? You know, where do we stand? If people and brothers and sisters could see where we were and where we are today, I think they would value and appreciate the camp experience more. They would value and appreciate everything that all the members are doing here. So it was a very loose, unstructured environment, but even with all that, you could still see the power in those scriptures. You could see the way it would affect the people, whether it was good or bad, you know, whether people were receiving the message while they're still the same spirits, I guess. But it was, I would say the first camp experience was just really overwhelming to me. I wouldn't say that I had fear, not at all. I was real zealous for this. It was just kind of uncertainty. You know, what do I do? Am I going to read? Am I not going to read? You know, and then I remember the first true experience that I would say the true experience for me, where I read and where we started developing structure to it, where I remember everybody got suspended from camp for the most part, and you had to be called in, even just to be a reader, not even just a teacher. And I remember it being an honor. It was at the Passover when they called our names to go back to camp to be a reader. Like, I felt like, you know how some brothers might feel when they've gotten promotions or things like that? That was in a promotion in of itself, to just be able to be called to go to camp, you know? Like, listen, we have that confidence in you to be our armor bearer, you know, to read those scriptures. And I remember being nervous leading up to when I was gonna read, you know, heart racing, and felt like I was gonna perform on stage or something. And I remember just going up there and just kind of just, you know, Officer Bezalel, I remember him telling me, you know, he quoted Matthews, where he was like, you know, just, you know, don't worry about what you're gonna say or what's gonna happen, it's just gonna come out. And It came out, and I was up there, and I felt like just the spirit was in me, and I was reading strong and loud and proud, and It was a real fulfilling experience for me.
All praises, all praises. All right, You're the high ranking Israel United now. You're one of the brothers that participate the most, and you play a big role in the functioning of the school. Explain to us in a somewhat strict but loose detail about what you're doing in this troop now.
I always find that hard to articulate what exactly I do, because I guess my hand is kind of like in everything. It was never supposed to be that way. I would say chiefly. the Most High ordained it that way, but I guess my plans were different in that way. Chiefly, I was gonna come in, and it was to use my experience dealing with finance and financial literacy, and to try to assist in that area. And I did. By the Spirit of the Most High, put the Spirit on me to step up. I also had some prodding from certain brothers like Josiah. to speak to the elder and offer my gifts. And started off with that. I helped kept developing that sort of thing. And I would say I'm kind of like, I guess I've always said this when people ask, I'm kind of like the general manager. I deal with like kind of all things administrative. Also now being with the recent promotion to the captain, more of a facilitator in kind of managing things. That's been my expertise from the world. And it's funny, I was speaking with my brother, Officer Parian, the other day, and I was telling him, short time ago, I had a revelation that everything that I experienced in my life, all these different promotions and things I got, in terms of worldly, I was considered successful. I had never went to college. I became a vice president at a bank. I was store manager's places with no college degree. Kid from the projects that did all this. So it seemed like it was a big thing. And I realize now that the Most High put me through those paces so I can bring those skills and those abilities here so that I can help develop and do the things here, and kind of just fill in that piece that was missing here at the time, and bring those kind of gifts for them. So, I just have a lot of life experiences and dealing in corporate and management and project management and different things like that. And, the Most High's kind of just brought that thing out for me more. My wife would even tell you, I often get more things done for the school than I do for anything in the house or anything else like that. It's not that I mean to neglect those things. They get done eventually, but I'm passionate about what I do. And it means a lot to me because of the vision and the mission that we have. And I know that if I don't play my role and play my position, that there's a lot of things that may not go through the way they need to. So, I take that responsibility seriously. We all have an integral role, but specifically for myself, I'm motivated by making sure that, I bring whatever steps I take, I bring things forward for our people.
All right, well, the scriptures do say, seek ye the kingdom of heaven first, and all these shall be added unto you. So, you're fulfilling it. Where do you see yourself in this truth in 10 years, and what do you see yourself doing in 10 years?
Man, if Christ don't return before then, I have plans. Some brothers have known, I want to move to Arizona, which is kind of weird because I had never thought that I would leave New York. I've left New York before, and I lived in Florida, Texas when I was in the military, and I always came back. I didn't like it. When I first started learning about this truth, I want to say maybe a month or two after, I was called, I had went to visit some friends in Arizona, and I just like instantly like fell in love with it. Now, I look at it in hindsight, and it's yet to be manifest what's going to happen. My intention is to move out there. As I look at it spiritually, I feel, right now, the Most High put that spirit on me to maybe move out there. There's a lot of Northern Kingdom coming up out there. I'm over the Phoenix camp that's out there. We got about 5-6 brothers out there now. And I'm the officer, the captain that's over them. And they're growing, and I see a need for, Northern Kingdom out there. You got a lot of Issachar, also a lot of Gad out there. So for me, my hopes are to go out there. Yes, I have my personal reasons why I feel I would want to be there. But again, I feel it's right now, I feel it's something that the Most High has put in my spirit to move out there. Lords will open up a chapter of IUIC out there and start to build out there, start hitting Issachar hard, start hitting Gad at the reservations and things out there, and, really help further this truth, there's so many plans that we have. You and I talk all the time, we're always brainstorming and stuff. I mean, Lord's will, in 10 years, man, we've taken this thing to levels that it's never seen before, you know? And, you know, by the Spirit of the Most High in Christ, we're able to wake up more people to this truth.
Right. Well said, bro. Well said. Okay, now turn to the camera. Give the brothers and sisters watching this an inspirational message and say your piece.
Inspirational message. I would say,
any scripture you like, anything from that, you got on
you. You know, I believe we were at Joshua 1:8 today, and that's kind of one of my guiding scriptures. Early on when I got into this truth, that's something that I try to live by. For me, that it kind of simplifies things. And, you know, summing it up, you know, that scripture is just talking about, you know, if you seek the commandments, similar to what Christ says, seek ye the kingdom first, then your ways will prosper. And, you know, I truly believe through the ups and downs of things that have happened, if you keep your eye on the vision, you know, never lose sight of the vision. And you know, early on you come into this thing and it's kind of like for selfish reasons. You know, the scripture says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And, you know, you do it for yourself first because you're afraid of the judgment that's going to come. And as you see the way you touch people, you know, I mean, from people crying in camp when you reveal Deuteronomy 28 and you bring these breakdowns down and the joy that you see in people, you know, that have had a question all their life, you know, that just something wasn't right and they couldn't get it. And whether it's by, you know, myself bringing forth a scripture or seeing another brother or an elder or a deacon, those things are moving. And I always say what keeps me driven in this is the weight of the responsibility we have for other brothers and sisters. So, you know, the inspiration really, I guess, would be in, you know, think about that, you know, think less about, you know, obviously you got to seek your own salvation, but think about every little thing you do. Nobody in this walk, from the newest member to the most senior person, is insignificant. You're not. You contribute in a big way. You're another brick in the wall, in the city that we're trying to build. And, you know, no matter what trials, no matter what comes through, if you meditate on those scriptures, whenever you're struggling or what have you, the answers are there. Everything is there for you. And the family unit that you have around you, take advantage of that. Take advantage of those brothers and sisters that are in this walk with you and grab a hold of that vision. Meditate on that vision and stay with it. Stay with it. And that's going to drive your every actions and everything that you do. That's it. So I say shalom.
Zephaniah. Over here with Officer Josiah. Officer Josiah, how did you come into the truth and what led you into this congregation?
I come from a home, mother, father, nuclear family, so to speak, two sisters, raised heavily like all so-called Hispanics are in Catholicism. Like a lot of brothers' stories, I always had a need for something else. I needed to be spiritually fulfilled. I needed something out there to validate what was going on around me or the things I was seeing. Fast forward, led me into drugs, led me into alcohol, led me into, you know, committing all the sin that we, you know, rebuke all our people of being in. And it took its toll on me. It put me in places I didn't want to be. I always had to struggle in myself within somebody who wanted to achieve and somebody who was still in their dirt. Still smoking weed, still hanging out, still committing sins, still acting like a knucklehead. So those two things play a part in my whole story. In FIT, I linked up with Officer Bezalel. We were studying computer animation and interactive media. So we're there, we're going through our thing, and like, you know, hear a lot of the brothers say, we start the doctrine of secret societies and conspiracy theories because we're looking. We're out there searching. The Most High put something inside of us that had us searching for these things. We didn't know at that time what it was, but we were searching. We definitely were searching, and whatever doctrine sounded good to us, that's kind of what we went with at the time. Then, at a certain time, we ran into Deacon Asaph. Deacon Asaph brought the scriptures out to us. And my story runs in parallel with Officer Bezalil's, because we were together at the same time the truth was being told, but the outcome was a lot different. So we hear the truth, and what I heard was, first I heard was, a white man was a devil, and I was all for it. I knew that, I didn't need anybody to second that story. I knew that 100% because I knew for a fact that they hated us. That was always clear to me in my life. The second was that our people were special, that our people were the chosen people. I heard that message and I said, you know what? I agree with that. I'm with that 100% because society teaches us that we're nothing, we're nobodies. We go through the most hardships. We, you know, you could go through all Deuteronomy 28, and that's what's reflected in our people. So I knew this wasn't the reality I was seeing. So when I first heard that, that was what clicked in my head. I said, you know what? The blacks, Hispanics, and Native Americans, they are the chosen people. Because there's a lot more to us than what society lets on. So after that, we did our research and we started going into the scriptures more and more and more. Hearing this information, I haven't made the choice until things got absolutely worse. By this time, Bezalel, he was going to the Wednesday class, he was going to the Sabbath, he made the decision to go, but I was still battling my demons. So things had to get real, real bad for me to just snap out of my position and say, you know what? I'm not doing nothing. I've wasted years and years and years of potential dealing with these fools that I thought were my friends at the time, but they weren't. So I had to get absolutely fed up and say, you know what? This ain't gonna happen no more. This is not, I refuse to let my life waste any more than it has already. So I said, you know what? I approached Bezalel one time. I said, all this time I knew ASAP, I knew Ithon, I knew Yahusab, but I never made it a point to start committing to the Sabbaths. So at this time, I told Bezalel, I said, you know what? I want to go, man. I want to go. And while I was working, I used to always listen to the Truth radio show, and I used to always get choked up because the brothers were speaking some real truth at the time. You know, when the water, like when the brother said, the water was at the ankles. So I'm listening to it. I'm like, yeah, man, you know what? Damn, this makes sense. So that convicted me in my spirit to maybe want to follow this a bit further. So I went down there. And this is Yahusab, Deacon Asaph.
When you say you went down there, where did you go?
It was in Coney Island, the first real gathering spot for Israel United in Christ. So I went, it was Deacon Asaph, Deacon Yahusab, Brother Jeremy at the time, he went there, he's no longer the truth now. We went there and the minute I walked in, I looked at Elder Nathaniel. From the first minute I saw him, I felt like I knew him before. It was a bit strange because I never physically met him. I never been around, you know, I was born and raised, you know, mainly in the Bronx. I had that strong feeling in my spirit. I said, bro, I know this brother. I know him. And I kept looking at him. He said, bro, why are you looking at me so crazy? I was like, do I know you from somewhere? And he was like, no, I don't. And then it was just bugged out. So that feeling overwhelmed me. So we start the lesson, and this is in his living room. We start the lesson and we go into it. He asked me, how do I know I'm an Israelite? And I said, in classic style, because I'm Dominican. Everybody gets a good laugh out of that. Then he goes, no, according to the scriptures. And I go, I don't know. So, and then we go into it. We change the topic, whatever he was going to teach, and he starts teaching Deuteronomy 28. So, I didn't know too much about so-called Dominican history, but, you know, I knew enough to identify ourselves. He goes into it, and you know, it was powerful. It was 2 hours of power. We were all in the scriptures. We went through all Deuteronomy 28, and at this point in the service, the bread and wine came up. And I remember I sat directly across from Deacon Anthony. And I said, give me the bread and wine. He goes, bro. He was trying to talk me out of it. I said, no. Give me that bread and wine. I said, this is the time. He said, I know. He's like, you sure, bro? I said, yes. I know. This is the time. So from that first time that I went, it was a wrap. Because I was already, my head was already in the Bible. I already knew, for the most part, what our people were going through and what was the way out. So when I heard it from Nathaniel, how he broke it down so smooth, I said, this is it. Let's get it popping. So at the first stages of Israel not in Christ, that's where I was. In literally in Nathaniel's living room in Coney Island.
All right. Well, praises. So how was your first camp experience? Whether it was holding post or teaching or reading, how was that for you?
Okay, that's a good story. First camp experience. The first camp experience, I'll say the brothers were at Eastern Parkway. And at the time, it was just Elder Nathaniel and former Elder Barack Shaw teaching. And we would just sit all on the benches lined up, you know, listening, taking notes, just being there while they do their thing. There were no officers set up. There were no deacons set up. It was just them. It was just them two going through their camp. And, you know, it was powerful. It was powerful. And it's also safe. I'll say that word, safe. Because we couldn't imagine that we would take it to this level from there. You know, if somebody would have told me that, I'd be like, man, you crazy. I'm just here to learn. So from there, everybody's dressed in plain clothes. We're all chilling in Eastern Parkway, going over the scriptures. It was a real loose environment. The warfare was, you know, the bullets weren't flying yet for us. For them, of course, they were. But for us, he was weaning us in very gently. So we leave Eastern Parkway, got dry. We leave from Eastern Parkway. We go to a spot. I'm not sure exactly where it was in Brooklyn. It was It was a real messed up neighborhood. The neighborhood was jacked up. And the first time, it was like a train stop, and it was a corner, the corner of a block. We're plotting out who's gonna teach next. And then he leans over to me, he goes, who's gonna read? Just asking vaguely. And I'm like, I ain't saying nothing. I ain't saying a damn thing. And Jan goes, bruh. This officer Jan, he goes, bruh, why don't you read? I go, shut up. I'm like, no, man, chill. I don't know. He goes to the elder, he goes, Josiah can read for you. And I'm like, oh, this dude done did it. Oh, man. Put me out there. He just threw my vote in the ballot.
Put you in the line of fire.
Hell yeah. He made sure them rifles were pointed at me. So I said, you know what? Dang. I can't back out now. It's gonna look like weakness. I got up there and I read, and I tried to go as loud as humanly possible. And I tried to make sure I was staring at my Bible, and I tried to make sure, don't lose the place, don't lose the place, don't lose the place. And I didn't know the fine tuning of how to read and all that, but I just read as loud and as powerful as I could. So at that time, I started reading it every chance I got. And eventually, you know, a year down the line, when I was a little more seasoned, I started teaching.
All right. Oh, praises, bro. So what are you doing in this truth now? And what do you see yourself doing in this truth in the next 10 years?
Okay. It's a nice beefy question right here.
Yes, it is.
All right. What am I doing for this truth now? Right now, I'm the senior editor of Israel United in Christ. I instruct a team of over 6 editors. I'm the head of operations for Original Royalty. I'm a high-ranking officer, so a lot of decisions made, you know, Lord willing, I'm the one in the midst of all that, you know, so you guys know. For this truth, I've always tried to apply my sense of organization, you know, the things I know to make us more professional, to make us more legit, as some people say. And anything that I excel at, I always apply towards the truth. Whether it be my attention to detail, my artistic skill, or even whatever I learned and whatever I was taught in the in Fashion Institute, the editing, the first one, you know, I was dealing with the website until other brothers took over. So that's the biggest thing I'm doing right now.
So what do you see yourself doing in the next? What do you see yourself doing in this truth in the next 10 years?
That's a great question. That's a great question. You know why? We always, as leaders in this truth, we always must ask ourselves, what can we bring to the table? What is our value? What is our worth? And that's something that can't be answered in a day. It takes time to develop that vision. So, what do I see myself doing in 10 years? I was trained in Esau's Kingdom to be a computer animator. That means you're dealing with, so-called computer animation movies you see today, like Pixar and Toy Story and all these other movies. I'd like to bring that to the truth. I'd like us to have records put to life of all our ancestors. King David, the Mighty Man, Solomon, Christ, when he walked the earth. I'd like to bring that vision towards the people, because when we pray, a lot of times we have that negative image of Caesar Borgia battling within our spirit. So I'd like to use my artistic vision to bring that to life, to mold and sculpt our people with that creativity. So with that being said, I'd like to make these movies. In 10 years, I'd like to put myself in the position to make these movies, so all our people can have these visions to look up to. As far as original royalty, I would love that it become the next Amazon, bigger than Amazon, because our people need things. And the key word, like brothers focused on before, was solidarity. We must and need to learn to go to our own for these things, not to always give our money to Esau. So I would like to build original royalty up to the point where we can buy things to set up your own church. We can buy all kinds of garments. We can buy fringes, all the things we need to be successful in this walk. That's how I want to set this up. And I want to make the company prosper and grow.
Crazy, brother. So, with that being said, I want you to look at the camera and whatever words of encouragement you have for brothers and sisters in this truth.
All right. Shalom, Israel. In this truth, the elder always gave me the message, to whom much is given, much is required. And I can tell you, as it is this day, and as it has been for literally about 7-8 years, there's never, the Most High Christ will never be satisfied. Your people can never be satisfied with what you have to put out there. You can't dwell or linger on your past accomplishments, because guess what? Tomorrow's a new day. You always have to show and prove. You always have to put your best foot forward. You always have to sacrifice. You always have to have sleepless nights. And I have plenty of those to attest to, but it's never enough. It's never enough. So, Israel, get your butt off that chair, contact us, contact the leadership, and sign on the dotted line and say, I'm ready to do this work. Shalom.
Shalom, Israel. I'm here with Officer Isaac of Israel United in Christ. We're going to ask Isaac some questions. Officer, how did you come into the truth and what led you as to being a part of this congregation as opposed to all the other congregations that are out there?
What led me into the truth was, all my life, first let me start off by saying I was raised in Catholicism. Right? My mother's from Haiti, so-called Haitian, and most Haitians predominantly, they're raised in Catholicism. So all my life, I always knew this problem. You know, going to these Catholic churches, the idols, the stuff that they were teaching was contrary to the Bible. Even though I wasn't too familiar with the Bible, I knew certain laws that they were teaching contrary to. Another problem that I had with the Catholic Church growing up, what made me uncomfortable, even as a young man, was the image of the Last Supper was all Europeans. And they always used to say that, you know, Christ came for everybody, Christ Jesus loves everybody. But in the picture of the Last Supper was only Europeans, it was not one Asian, one Arab, and one so-called black man. So something always, you know, struck a nerve with me that there was something wrong with that picture. And not only that, but Israel is in the Middle East, on top of Africa. So I went to college in Virginia, Norfolk State University, which is down south, and which is an all-black historical college. And through there, I was doing a lot of research, getting, you know, in touch with my roots, if you want to say. And I was researching on the Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. They had something called the Black Wall Street over there. Ended up coming back into New York. But while I was in VA, I was dabbling into other religions, trying to find myself, because I walked away from Catholicism. I was in Islam for like a week. Went to the mosque, got kicked out of the mosque for sleeping. Got warned, don't sleep in the mosque. I was passing out. They were doing their stuff in Arabic. Fell asleep. The brothers escorted me out the mosque, and I realized, no, this is not for me. So, long story short, I came back to New York and just doing, you know, research online. I came across a camp known as GMS. Learned that the white man was the devil, something I already knew. Learned the history part of Israel through Great Millstone. And then that was all I was learning. It's like I hit a ceiling. Just the white man's the devil, the white man's the devil. The white man's going to slavery, the white man's going to slavery. Nuclear missiles, that's all that I knew. So the water was a little below the ankles with GMS. So then I ran into GOCC and was uncomfortable with that camp because they had Edomites in their camp. They were teaching that everybody would be saved. But I learned the whole Illuminati aspect with them. So one time I came home and I prayed to the Most High, so the Most High could lead me into the right direction. And then one day I stumbled upon Elder Daniel's video with Barak Shaw at the time. So I took it upon myself to call, and I left a message. Barak Shaw returned my phone call and told me to come. He gave me the address, 1088, told me to come through. And he also told me, you know, we don't teach that all nations could be saved. And I told him, no. And that's how I wound up at Israel United in Christ. And I still remember my first day going over there. I seen the elder. I walked in, the elder was teaching. I was starstruck because I used to see Elder Daniel videos and now he's here in person. I was so starstruck that I didn't even go up to the table at the end of the class to introduce myself, tell him, you know, hello Elder, I'm such and such, nice to meet you, this is why I'm here. And one time during the classes, I think it was my third time there, at the end of during the class, Elder Daniel had said how, you know, some brothers, you know, they're new and they just come here, they don't have no respect, they don't even say hello, whatever. And I knew he was talking about me. And And I never got a chance to apologize to him, even to this day. It was just, it wasn't out of disrespect, but more of a, you know, I felt like it was more respect, you know? So, yeah, that's how I ended up at Israel United in Christ.
Crazy, bro, crazy. Explain to us how your camp, your first camp experience was. Either be handing out flyers, holding poles, reading, or teaching.
My first camp experience was at the last Sabbath of every month. We allowed the new brothers to go out, and I was fortunate for that situation. I was allowed to come out to join the fast the last Sabbath, and as a surprise to me, the Deacon Shockett, and he was here in New York. He told me, I'm going to give you 10 minutes. And I was like, what? 10 minutes of what? 10 minutes of holding posts or handing out flyers? Like, nah, 10 minutes to teach. And I went up, and to be honest with you, it felt natural. It felt natural. I was a little nervous, but it felt natural. You know, some of the deacons, they were surprised. Some of them asked me if I could talk before, that I did good. And it just flowed like water. It felt natural. It felt like something that I was ordained to do, to go out and speak to the people.
You're crazy. Well, that sounds good. All right, as a high-ranking officer in this troop, explain my view of what you're doing now for the troop, like what are your responsibilities, what things do you partake in, and where do you see yourself in this troop in the next 10 years?
Okay, what I'm doing now is going out, teaching, as an officer of 50, an overseer of the flock, make sure that I'm correct, make sure I get myself even more correct so I can help edify the body, so I can be a role model to the young brothers coming up. I'm also part of the video team, helping with editing some of the videos to help push the truth, you know, to another level. But what I enjoy the most really is the teaching aspect. Because you can go out at camp, you can teach to thousands, hundreds of people that walk by, and just being able to touch one soul, that means a lot. Like the scripture says, if one repentant soul comes into the truth, the angels rejoice in heaven.
Okay, we got a fitness movement going on.
Also, we do have a fitness movement that's going on. You know, with my background in the health science field, you know, personal trainer, health science, exercise physiology, and my experience of how the human anatomy works. You know, we implemented the health fitness in Israel United in Christ to help the big body brothers get into shape. You know, not to make exercise a priority, but just basically to get your mind, body, and spirit working as one, to where you can prolong your life by the grace of God, so where you can go out, be healthy, and teach the people, you know, longevity.
And have energy to deal with Israel.
And, yeah, definitely have energy, because Israel will drain you of all your energy.
All right, what do you see yourself doing in this troop for the next 10 years?
If I'm still in New York, you know, Lord's will, if I'm still in New York, to just, you know, Lord's will, probably become an elder one day myself, Lord willing, if that's what the Most High wants me to do. You know, be here to teach the people, awaken as many souls as I can. You know, because through this work, as you grow and experience in this truth, you see the lives that we touch. Whether if it was a you know, gangbanger, homosexual, you know, adulterer, whoremonger, whatever. Because we have people that in every different walks of life that come into this truth. And just being able to transform one person into an Israelite, a repentant Israelite, that's a beautiful thing. Deacons, the elders, the deacons sit amongst the elder, you know, edifying the body, being a watchman over the flock. Lord's willing, I like to do that one day. If I'm still in New York, you know, be a deacon myself. Lord willing, if I'm not in New York, and if I reside in any other state outside of New York in the future, you know, possibly start up my own school, my own camp, following under the Honorable Elder Danny, right, and the Israel United in Christ. And just help awaken more souls. That's what we're here for. We're not here for ourselves, we're here for others.
All right, now, here's a portion of our interview where you turn to the camera, give the brothers and sisters watching an inspirational message, and say your piece.
All right, brothers and sisters, shalom to you brothers out of state that are watching this interview right now. I would like to say whatever you're going through, whatever affliction you're going through, whatever sin you're battling, there's always going to be trials and tribulations. Right? Just like it says in Acts 14, verse 22. All right, whatever tribulation you're going through, we have to overcome it to inherit the kingdom of heaven. All right, whatever you do, do not turn your back on this truth. Whether you fall, the scripture says a man falls 7 times and get back up. Whatever you're doing, keep pressing. Don't turn your back on this truth. There's nothing out there in the world. There's nothing out there in the world. All right? If you want to inherit the world, you got to endure this truth. And with that, I say shalom.